eyeballs staring you down. I hate that. I absolutely hate that. You'll see me while we're doing this. Yep. I will be moving like this, turning around, looking at that, doing that, because I am a crew of one. Normally you have people who are like the sound guy and the other guy. Mm-hmm. Anyway, you know, when would you say that you first find out that there are these things called BBSs out there?
I remember it was January of 1979.
And what happened?
Well, I was at the time, had just started becoming a consultant, computer consultant. I was 19 years old. This was just after the TRS-80 was introduced with the floppy disk drives. And I ended up getting a project that was from the RKO Radio Network, research. And RKO had stations in New York, all the big markets, New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Memphis was one. That's where I was based in Memphis at the time. And they wanted to get the music research results sent into their headquarters out in California. So Radio Shack had a 300 baud Cat 2 modem that you could drop your phone into, and we started playing around with that. And it was about that time I discovered that there was such a thing as bulletin boards out there. But I didn't actually connect to my first bulletin board until March of 1979. And I will never forget that when I actually connected to it. It was just so magical, I thought, that here it was, my computer in my bedroom was actually communicating with another computer located somewhere else. And I knew I had to learn all I could about it. And that's where I started.
Do you remember the name of that bulletin board?
Form 80. SysOp was Arnie Graber. I even remember the telephone number.
So it was a TRS-80 board, actually.
Yes, it was. Mm-hmm. The other BBS in town was a, what was it? It was run on Apple, ABBS, that's right. It was run by the local computer lab store. They put it up at night on their main number.
So, I mean, at this point, you're getting 300 baud, though.
Correct. I remember when 110 was normal and 300 baud was the fast line.
Now, what about those early BBSs, kept you coming back?
The communications, the messaging. It was incredible to sit there and be able to message other people in your community and have, we had discussions, political discussions, hobbies, do whatever. You could only store, I think, 100 messages on a Form 80 and they'd start revolving out automatically. Things like that. But we had some pretty heated political discussions, but nothing of a problem until Christmas 1980 when the Commodore kiddies came online. You know, we had our $4,000 and $5,000 computers that kind of kept the price of admission rather high, and then all of a sudden you had these $4.95 Commodores coming in with the kids and they started disrupting stuff. But before that, it was great.
All right, so for you, it's like 1980 when the as I call them, the January loser crowd comes in, the ones who get the modems for Christmas.
December 1980, January 81. I definitely remember that.
So for you, the first BBSs were not intentionally, but an adults-only club.
Correct. Just by the fact it cost a lot to get there.
And how exactly did the quality of it change for you?
Well, you had a lot of kids on there. So, you know, kind of what you might see today, except not as much, if you ever go to a kid's site or something. But kid stuff, that's all I could say. I was only 20, 21 at the time, but I remember even talking with one a couple of years ago. One of my coworkers was telling how he got his Commodore at Christmas. I said, "Oh, you're the guys who wrote it for us."
Now, certainly through the early '80s, from '77 to about '80. If you want to play games, I guess '86 when the Amiga comes out. Mm-hmm. There's this burst of completely divergent platforms arriving that just have nothing to do with each other. Different approach to graphics, different everything else. Mm-hmm. Do you remember Any aspect of that on a bulletin board basis? I mean, did you start seeing, do you remember?
Oh, no, not at that time. You were just lucky to be pure text, and that was it. We never got into graphics at that point. Starting in the late 1980s was when you started to see ANSI drivers, ANSI graphics, color, things like that, but not before then.
But, I mean, you didn't see, like for instance, I had one guy who, he was a Atari person, for example, I think it was. No, he was something else. But all the bulletin boards that he was on were all Commodore boards, and therefore they were all 40 columns.
Oh, now, formatting, yes. You could definitely, I mean, Apple BBS was always 40 columns, things like that. The Form 80s initially were 64. They later, Bill Abney came out, I think, with an upgrade that would allow it to do 80 characters when I got Model 2, which supported that. So, yeah, in regards to graphics, just text resolution, right.
Did you witness any of the OS warring? Any of the machines versus other machines or people coming on to boards that you were on to go, ha-ha, trash 80s and get out of there?
Oh, yeah. Stuff like that, sure, of course.
Any memories?
No, not really. No. I mean, I made my money on trash 80s, and they did very good for a number of years.
I interviewed Eric Green, who wrote The Green Machine.
Yeah.
In Georgia. And he talks about, the specific power of the TRS-80 that apparently a lot of people who didn't have them just didn't understand. I mean, was it a case of the TRS-80 was the TRS-80 just the first machine you got, so it's the machine you learned the best, or did you look around and say, this is the one for me?
It was the first machine that I purchased, but I'd been using, my first machine was a PDP 1105 from school, so that's where I learned my programming skills. I worked on a Commodore PET, which I still own, ended up buying it a couple years later at a ridiculously low price, and it still runs with all 7,167 bytes of memory. And chiclet keyboard, I might add. But the TRS-80 was the first one I really bought, and I dove into it, and I learned a Z80 assembler and could even disassemble Z80 code looking at it in memory. You know, LDIR, a 3E00, I believe, hex. I could pick those things out. It was a beautiful machine. It had a lot of power in it. Yeah, and Radio Shack was always, I remember we were trying to get information out of them on how to do things, and they were very reluctant to spill the beans. And then we had some series of books written by Harv Pennington about TRS, Disk Basic, and other mysteries. That stuff was great.
You know, as time goes on in the computer world with BBSs and stuff, there's more and more people who are getting computers and being on BBSs who they don't have that background. In other words, assembler is just, I mean, it's either just a word or it's this arcane spell that you're just not to go near.
Exactly.
And the concept that, for instance, the BASIC that they're programming in might be written in assembler is just too much for them. A computer language is a computer language. You don't write one in another.
Mm-hmm.
You have the first one. It's crazy. Do you remember coming up against that? Do you remember when that really starts affecting you or noticing it? Like the change?
Well, since I was self-employed until 1996, I didn't see it until about then, because I was pretty much my own person at that time. And anybody I communicated with was kind of in a similar when the business failed, and I ended up getting into the corporate world. I started to see some people like that, of course, and as the years have gone on, more and more so that. I'm now a manager with the Tennessee Department of Transportation, and almost all of my programmers have no concept of assembly or writing tight code, or they're all used to having a database connection right there, ready to go. They have no concept of how to balance a B tree and stuff like that, and write your own low-level routines. So you're right that we're breeding a different class and style of programmer, but they are, in their own way, very, very good. They're much better than I am, I have to say, in many ways. They'll grasp a higher concept faster than I will, because I may be bogging down trying to figure out kind of a little bit behind the scenes, how does it work? where they just accept it and go on.
Now, oh, I see what's going on here. Give me a moment. There's just sure. I'm making what would be called an extremely typical mistake, which is, all right, let me do this. Pause. All right, let's see. So, as you can see, I'm going around the lost lore.
Yeah.
Of programming, you know, because there's a, you know, one thing that does make itself obvious now is that what you end up now with are these semi-well-constructed large blocks of programming, so that somebody is able to assemble those interestingly. But if you look at any one of the singular blocks, they're extremely inefficient.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're able to do more because there's all these pre-built blocks for them where other people didn't have that, and people would rewrite interfaces from scratch every time. But on the other hand, you don't get a lot, you know, like, you know, people are like, well, when you run my program, it's going to take 32 megabytes to run my program. And there's a certain class who would go, then you've done it entirely wrong. You're, you know, your program shouldn't be 32 megabytes. You've made a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, but it works. And it works fast on these extremely fast machines.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other hand, there's programs that I use where the runtime, the program installation is 200K. And the program comes up and does all these incredible things. And I'm mm-hmm. like, that's a guy who didn't just, you know, set the optimizer on full and hope.
Exactly. You're right. I've seen things where my programmers have done, they've looked for a solution, and I'll go back into some technique from 15, 20 years ago, pull it out and say, try this, and they, you know, it works, of course. Well, sometimes it doesn't, I guess, but, you know, they hadn't ever thought of the problem in that manner.
Now, one of the, hopefully the light is correct as I ask about your major accomplishment.
Okay.
Let's double check that. But no, I mean, one of the things that one might argue is that you use those skills to come up with the solution of quick packets. In other words, you say, well, there's, you know, I mean, I'm assuming here, but I'm assuming the reason that you made them or come up with them is to solve a problem.
Correct.
And you say, well, how do we solve that problem? And those skills that you have from those early days are things like, you know, geez, the machine doesn't actually put anything on the screen very quickly. How do I fix that? As opposed to, hey, this thing that I just programmed doesn't look as nice as it could. So, I mean, you look at a problem, and then you go in, and your solution is to completely turn the process of how bulletin boards interact on its head.
Well, I remember the genesis of Qmail. It was back in September of 1985. My wife and I were on a vacation in the Smoky Mountains, and one afternoon we come down from the mountains, and my wife had a headache and was tired, so she took a nap, and I went outside in front of the hotel we were staying at, and with my trusty issue of Byte magazine, and I got there, sat down, and thought about bulletin boards for a few minutes. And there were one thing that was happening to bulletin boards about that time was the concept of measured service, where you would be billed by the telephone company for the actual minutes you used on the telephone, rather than a flat fee per month. And I thought of two things. I said to myself, what would happen to our hobby if a flat rate went away and was replaced by measured service? And I thought a little bit about packet radio. I thought a little bit about, well, the idea would be you would want to encapsulate as much of the BBS information, the experience, into a packet as you can, crunch it down with, at the time, ARC, and then transmit that, make it as quick as possible, hang up, and then at your leisure read the mail, answer it, and then call back quickly, upload your reply, and get out. The other the opposite end of that spectrum was what would happen if costs to communicate went to zero and you could connect anywhere in the world free of charge, which we know today is the internet. So, and I said, well, that would kill the hobby too. But I decided that doing something where we could compress everything, messages, new files, bulletins, into a packet and then transmit that one file would be the most efficient way to do it. And then I forgot about it for probably probably a year, year and a half. And we had this, we were PC board users in Memphis. Everybody has their own clique. You know, you had the people who used our BBS and hung out on our BBS systems. Well, I was into the PC board scene with a guy named Jim Key in Memphis who ran a bulletin board called Radio Free Memphis. And we had another sysop who was running a PC board in Memphis named Jim Potcotter. What I decided to do one time was just to take a PC board message base, reverse engineer it. I didn't know who wrote it or anything. I just said, let me take a look at it and see what I can do. And I wrote an Qmail system for these two systems. And when you have Qmail between two systems, it's pretty easy to do because, you know, if it didn't originate from your system, it originated from the other system. And then we got another system out in California named Sleepy Hollow, a sysop named Jim Fouch, who wanted to join the network. And then I had to rewrite the software again because I said I hadn't planned for a third note. That was the trouble. It's like a juggler keeping three balls in the air. And it grew from there. We started doing Qmail. It grew into something called Interlink, eventually iLink. That eventually came around to Quick Packets, but this was before that. I wrote a clone of PC, Procom, at least the Procom script language, a telecommunications system that would script all this stuff out and exchange the mail. So that was the beginning of it. Well, I'm telling you this because one of our Jim Key's users was a guy named Dan Maschek. And Dan, in August of 87, moved from Memphis down to a little town called Wharton, Texas, outside of Houston. And he would always call back up long distance to Memphis to read the messages on Radio Free Memphis because he didn't want to lose the group. And I remember one day, Jim was saying, oh boy, I mean Dan was saying, oh boy, man, my wife's going to kill me about these long distance phone bills. And I remembered my idea from Gatlinburg in 85. And I said, well, hold on a minute. I know how Qmail works. I know how PC board is designed. Let me see if I can't do something based on that. And I came up with a very prehistoric Qmail system at that point. And I gave it to Dan, and he just, you know, it cut his phone bills down dramatically and stuff like that. And then I had other sysops who wanted it. Everybody who was on our Qmail network decided they wanted to get a copy. So I decided, all right, I'll take the time and redo this system based all on PC board, because all of us were PC board users at this time. So we had people like a sysop named Phil Gordmer out in New Jersey, Phil Stultz in Indianapolis, Ed Hopper down in Houston. All these people were wanting my program. Then I decided this could be maybe some income. And I thought, what I will do is I'll sell the board, the door, Qmail door. I think I had a 50 conference system for $50, a 100 conference system for 75, and I think it was like maybe 128 or something like that for $100, because PC board had a 10 conference limitation at the time that the developer wasn't fixing. So I just added these conferences offline. That worked out well. I said I would sell the door and just throw out the clients or the readers at the time free of charge. That way they would drive the sales of the doors. And that's what I did. I remember releasing it on April the 15th, 1988. I was at the Federal Express Hub at midnight getting all the packets to ship out. I think I had 32 of them that night because that was release. And it really took off. I never thought that it would be a business that I could actually make money at. I think I ended up selling about 2,400 copies of the door, over 25,000 copies of the reader, you know?
I didn't realize that you had... So you're saying there were cases in PC board where the only way to access the conference was via Quick Packets.
Correct.
So they were this complete other world if you didn't have the client.
Exactly. It helped drive it. Yes, you try to add value to the system.
Now, the model now... Mm-hmm. The model that takes off for a short time in the 90s, The model that takes off for a short time in the 90s is that very one, which is, give away the server for free. I mean, sorry, not the opposite, sorry. The model is...
Client.
Yeah, give away the client for free and charge buttloads of money for the server.
Which we didn't call them those at the time. Right. But they were.
Right. Did that come from anywhere, or was that just a logical progression that you did?
Logical progression. I don't think... Let me think about this. You know, I mean, you could go back to Gillette razor blades and see that as being a part of the model, but nothing really... I didn't say, oh, he did it, so I will too.
Okay, that's what I mean. Because sometimes, like, for instance, I can trace... very quickly, there's a system called Plato in the 60s that's a popular computer messaging system in the University of Chicago. Yep. At one point, it can have up to 1,000 simultaneous users, and you can trace everything from it. There's like, they come up with a way to send system notification, and it's called Plato Notes, and one of the people who uses it is Ozzy, who creates Lotus Notes, and it has a dungeon game called Obelette, and one of the young admins whose job was to put people on this game is named Silas Warner, who goes off and creates Castle Wolfenstein. And so you can get like first-person shooters from this thing. And so there's like a lot of stuff like that. I just didn't know if, like, for instance, you found yourself buying something, getting something in the mail for free, and then, you know.
Okay. No, I didn't. I don't remember anything like that. I didn't think I'd make money off the readers at the time, but later on that changed too.
Well, one could always argue that, I mean, that's the way you get, you know, there's different arguments to both ways, but it's a way, you know, it's a way that some people approach their business, and so it's interesting that you take that one. Do you open the spec at that time?
No, I did not really open the spec, if I remember right, till about the 1992 or something like that. I always felt that I didn't need to help anybody trying to clone and take away my business. I took that attitude. I'm a student of the Wright brothers, and I realized that what they went through with the invention of the airplane probably colored my opinion of how to defend my intellectual property at the time as well. So they didn't help out their competitors, and neither did I.
the whole, you know, quick packet system, did you... Do you have memories of people's reaction to it?
Oh, yeah. Everybody was, I mean, nobody had a unfavorable reaction. It was, we can get more people. Okay, back then, you didn't have these massive multi-line BBSs. You may have, if you had two or three lines, you were a fairly good board, size board at the time. So a lot of sysops realized that if they had a Qmail system installed in their system, and they gave the readers to their most prolific users, then they could get in and out quickly, get more users per hour in the system, and service more people. And that probably ended up helping grow more lines if they added subscriptions to the system because they were generating the traffic to offset the cost of the operation of the board. It kind of grew.
Were you surprised when BBSs started charging for subscriptions?
No. No, not a bit. Those who did, for the most part, I felt were justified because they're providing a fair amount of content for what they were charging. And it wasn't, I don't think anybody had an extremely high price at all. It was usually a flat fee for a year.
Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly, you know, PC Board is one of the pioneers in what later becomes the BBS industry. Mm-hmm. You know, here's a BBS program, and it costs you this amount of money. Which, from the point of view of kids my age, you know, immediately we pirate the heck out of it. And I remember that, I forgot exactly what it was, but there was some aspect to it where it was particularly difficult to pirate. There was a pretty good back and forth for a while between us and Salt Air. And you know, there was always like, PC Board had insane version numbers, not unlike our BBS, where like, you know, I mean, they're like a 12, 13. You know, and people were like, I got 12, I got 12.5, I got, you know, they're buying right into the version numbers. But yeah, I mean, PC Board is generally sold. So, I mean, I would assume that you decide, I mean, is your product PC Board only?
Well, you know what, that's a good point. And that's, you do raise a good point. Yes, that's probably one of the reasons I charged, was because I was in a PC Board market that was already, sysops were already used to spending money buying the BBS. I seem to remember that's true.
You know, once you have them, I mean, certainly, for instance...
Also like money.
I mean, yeah, so for you, this is an obvious question, but I mean, it sounds like for you, money in computers and charging people for using them is...
I was a consultant at the time, freelance, making my living about 10 years at the time, off of doing systems around the Memphis area for customers, so I was used to getting paid for my work.
So it was just another logic, because that's... There's certainly a spasmodic back and forth for a good long time between people who are like, you know, not just, hey, I can't afford it. You know, it's one thing when the pirates are kids who are under 18, where every dollar is just, you know, a meaningful thing. Mm-hmm. And then there's the people who are like, won't pay on principle. The idea of not just I can get it for free over here, but I shouldn't have to pay for this. And then you have that tension. And that goes back to the 70s.
Yes, you're right. And then you got the PC board sysops who were already paying money, and I knew they were conditioned for it. Excellent point. I mean, I'm sure I realized that back then, but I'd forgotten over the years.
Do you remember any of the other... No. Well, I would assume you don't find out about Boardwatch until late 80s or early 90s.
Late 80s. I think if I remember right, Jack contacted me one day, and we just had a 30-minute conversation. One of those things. It was a great. He's a great guy. You don't ever have a 3-minute conversation with Jack.
So he actually goes out of his way to find you.
Yeah.
But previous to that, I just want to get that small segment of time in your life, apparently, uh-huh. where you're charging for a product on BBS's for a pay BB, you know, for a BBS product uh-huh. that you don't make. So you're basically a third-party vendor.
Right.
Did you become aware or interact with other third-party vendors that you remember?
With BBSing, let's see, PKR, that was C, and that would have been, help me out here.
Phil Katz.
No, that's PK Computing, oh. PK Ware.
Okay, you're saying PK, well, because ARC was, PK ARC is PK, and ARC is...
Just ARC, it was ARC by C okay. Associates. Tom Henderson,
yes.
Yes, I talked with him quite often in the early years, and especially when he was going through the lawsuit with Katz and things like that, because I felt he was being victimized as well, someone, you know, stealing his code, and, well, I better not say that, but whatever. He was in the same situation I felt I was, where he had a competitor. And a lot of BBS, a lot of people thought that Tom should have just been the open-handed guy and say, here, let me help you, and all this stuff. So we talked a lot. John Friel, who wouldn't be categorized as a third-party vendor for any bulletin board, except, of course, he developed Qmodem, which called all these BBSs. He and I talked quite a lot in the early years.
Now, did you find any... Did you find any desire or need to, like, create a coalition? Or, you know, was it just like a bumping into another test pilot and just chatting it up?
More like the latter, very much so. Just comparing notes, how do you do this in your business, how does this work, how's, things like that. I've never been big on coalitions, things like that. I think the closest I've ever come was one night in... Colorado Springs for the 93 BBS Con, where Friel and Jeff Woods from Telex and I were sitting around having dinner, and we said, you know, we should write a book about our experiences.
Just to go on the PK ARC versus the ARC versus PK ARC, or if you prefer SEA versus Phil Katz Associates,
probably
battle. You know, one thing that's a very interesting perception that I found going back and researching this, was that, you know, PKware is three people. Mm-hmm. It's Phil, his mom, and another guy.
PK Mom, yep.
Yeah. And C, or System Enhancement Associates, is four people. You know, it's Tom, his wife, his brother, I think, and someone else. Mm-hmm. But there's all this constant perception that Phil Katz is one guy in a trailer, and SEA is a big building mm-hmm. from the 50s full of 100 people, crushing him with lawyers.
Right.
It sounds like in that battle you side with Tom?
I did. Because I felt that at the time that Phil was, from what I understand, he basically added buffering. That's about use concept of huge buffering to the system. So that's all I can. I don't have any intimate knowledge, things like that. But I know that the BBS sysops are saying, "Wow, PKZip works so much faster, does such a better job." Why they couldn't understand why Tom wasn't there, just saying, "Help this guy out because he's helping us." And when they finally sued, there was that huge, you know, mass exodus away from ARC over to PKZip at that time. And that sealed it pretty much for him. I'm not sure. I haven't talked with him probably since 1989 or 90, somewhere around there.
SEA trips along till 1992 when they sell off to their company. And Tom leaves New Jersey and moves back down, I believe, to North Carolina. Mm-hmm. North Carolina, South Carolina, on the beach.
Oh, what's he doing now?
I mean, one of the interesting things that really strikes me about that entire back and forth, and I'm interviewing Tom, hopefully, coming soon, but if you go to Tom's page, when Phil Katz dies, it has now been 12 years since the lawsuit, by the time Phil Katz dies in 2000, and Tom Henderson writes a eulogy in which he implies that the reason that Phil Katz died of alcoholism was over guilt of stealing ARC. And this is what, he writes this like as soon as Phil Katz dies. Mm-hmm. He says, you know, in our thing it says if you steal our, you know, he quotes from their own little thing where at the bottom it says, you know, if you steal from us, the guilt will haunt you to the end of your days. And he says, and I think that's what happened here.
Mm-hmm.
So 12 years afterwards, he's more than willing to spit on that guy's grave. That's how angry he obviously is about the whole thing. Tom Henderson is a very interesting character to me before meeting him, simply because he intersects in three or four different places.
Yes,
he's actually involved in three or four major controversies.
FIDO?
Yeah, well, more than just FIDO, the International FIDONet Association.
Right.
Which, you know, I have quite a bit of footage and discussion and things about that.
Better have a half hour. At least.
I mean, were you a FIDONet person at any? Okay. See.
No, I never was. I found out after I developed Qmail about the point system in FIDONet. But I mean, did I ever call up a FIDO bulletin board? Yes, I did, but I never developed.
Okay. And you didn't. I mean, so you're not. I mean, but it sounds like you're aware of some of the controversies of FIDO.
One of my good friends was a super regional out of Kansas City, Roy Timmerman. So, and he was involved in some of that. So I got to hear all the blow-by-blow descriptions.
You know, one of the things that really strikes me about FIDO is that what a lot of people come away from with FIDO is this just sense of having gotten out of a war.
Anarchy. Yes. Where the other side of the coin was pretty much what the PC board networks were. You had PC Relay, which became Rhyme under Bonnie Anthony. That was almost monolithic in its management. iLink was ruled by basically a committee, and you would not steer out of that. If you did too much, you could be dropped. Yeah, FIDONet was like, you know, Hatfields and McCoys all the time.
You know, the International FIDONet Association is an attempt to create a third-party committee that would regulate FIDONet, and it is an astounding failure. And in my travels, it's partially an astounding failure because Tom brings in a lawyer who everything he says pisses off people more. Every time he opens his mouth, he makes them angrier.
Really?
Until he finds, like this lawyer, and I have Tom Jennings on footage talking about this situation where just before this big meeting where they're going to vote on it, they're going to give an award to Tom, and they bring him up to the hotel room where the lawyer is. The lawyer basically says, you know, well, we're going to have this vote on this IFNA thing today, and if you go with it, you know, if you endorse it, you know, we'll be a shoo-in. So, you know, it'd be really good if he did that. And if not, we'll probably get it anyway, and then you won't get a piece of the pie. And this was the completely wrong thing to say to Tom Jennings.
I can imagine that.
So Tom Jennings goes downstairs, they give him his award, he turns to the mic, and he says something. And whatever he says causes the entire convention to break up. Literally, everyone gets up, walks around, and breaks into, like, discussion groups, and they're trying to get everyone back together, and it's just never going to happen. And I really want to get that. But
you don't know what he said, do you?
I don't know exactly. Well, I know in paraphrase what he said.
Oh.
So, you know, he just basically said, "Hi, thanks for the award. This is all crap. You shouldn't vote for any of this. This is the worst idea ever. It completely completely destroys anything I believed in with it. And, you know, have a nice day." And then storms off the thing.
I do remember when that happened. Yep.
Yeah, and everyone was like, "Oh, Tom, Tom Henderson is at the center of that. He's at the center of his business.
Yeah.
He's at the center of one or two other things." And so basically, he gets into BBS's, exerts an enormous amount of energy, and comes away completely screwed over in everything. His hobby thing that he's doing gets screwed over, his business. So, I mean, you know, just...
Interesting. In my conversations with him, I didn't have, like, daily conversations or anything, but maybe 10 or 15 phone calls down the way. Nicest guy. Like, I would have nothing bad to say about him from conversations.
That's the thing. I think what also really angered people about the SEA thing was they claimed intellectual property rights on the extension arc.
They did, yes.
And that shocked people.
He was just ahead of his time.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're looking around today at software patents, which I don't like.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, that's a case of people just... I remember a utility which would convert all of your ARC packets to .su.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that you could do that. Mm-hmm. Now, so you create quick packets,
mm-hmm.
and that changes how people use bulletin boards. Do you remember some of the ways that you know it changed people?
Yes, I do, because... Well, of course, it allowed more people to get into the bulletin boards than they could before. And, of course, encouraged more messaging because you could sit there and enter in, reply to topics you might normally not because of the frustrations of entering a message online, tying up your telephone line longer than you needed to, things like that, as I said before. Other areas that I noticed was the most important and most gratifying one was one I never even thought of when I created it. And that was that handicapped users suddenly could join in and use bulletin boards. If they were not able to type with their hands, nobody could enter a message in online using a mouth stick. But I had an association with a couple of systems, one of which was Ability Online up in Toronto, where they would have handicapped and kids and people, and they would... Yeah, you'd use mouth sticks and stuff like that to type in their messages, and they felt that they could join in and communicate, be a part of discussions again, and that was very, very positive. I put some things inside the code that would help handicapped users a lot easier. I can't remember right now exactly what, but there were a few. One thing I remember being blown away by was one of my users who would call my bulletin board system, Sparky's machine, was he was a regular user. And he wanted to chat with me one day, and it turned out to be Memorial Day weekend. And he was chatting very slowly and typing slowly, and I found out he was a Vietnam vet and that he was using my product and that he was asking about how to go ahead and if he could register right now and get a key file. And I started at that point, I never publicized it, but if I found out you were a disabled vet, I'd give it to you free of charge. And I started with him. I cannot remember his name right now. One thing was curious, and this was brought out in Boardwatch magazine, that when they did a survey in 92 of the, name your favorite bulletin board systems, they found out, I think, something like 30% of the recipients mentioned that their favorite bulletin board system was in another area code than where they lived. So they attributed that completely to the use of offline mail packets and being able to span geographic distances efficiently, which of course is why I wrote it for Dan Maschek. So things like that I noticed. Plus you could start integrating, at the very end of the system, before the internet hit, I was trying to integrate multimedia into it better. We could play sound files offline, things like that.
And, you know, I don't know when you first, or if you do, when you bump into your first clone.
Oh, I remember. Every developer remembers that moment.
Go ahead.
Easy Reader. Eric Cockrell. It was probably about December of 1988.
Yep.
And he called, we talked for probably about an hour, and I told him that my philosophy, that I'm in this for business and things like that, and, you know, I can't stop you and things like that, but don't expect help, and, you know, basically laying down my thoughts and things like that. And you had, that was the very beginning of it. Yep.
Was his motivation money, or was it just, I can do it better?
I think it was more, I can do it better. And he did in many ways, because at the time I was, well, up, First Reader, Qmail Reader, all of them were written in compiled BASIC, Quick BASIC. Starting in 1989, I picked up a library that allowed me, that was highly optimized, that allowed me to create code that was almost as tight as C. But before that, it was Microsoft runtimes, the abomination. Sure, anybody who knew C could, and he did, I believe it was written in C, he could make it a lot tighter, make it look a lot better, but he had his own problems too. And you always have to deal with, your business only stands as good as you can handle your customer service and relations. And I hope I did okay on that.
Do you know how big the offline mail reader industry gets? I mean, do you stay on top the whole way through, or do you get?
Well, there was never a Arbitron rating or something like that, Nielsen ratings, things like that. All I can tell you is I sold 25,000 copies over the years of the reader, and I don't know if other vendors exceeded that quantity or not. Probably Mustang did with their OLX, but they had, you know, a fairly good marketing effort behind that as well. That's for sure. Plus, they went into the Windows market where I didn't at that point. So that cut that down.
They also owned the cart as well as the fruit they were selling and the horse that was pulling it.
Exactly. The Henry Fordman, you know, owned the town, owned everything. It makes distribution a whole lot easier.
It sounds like you're able to support yourself on it.
Oh, yes. I was. My consulting agency, my consulting business slacked off to where I only kept a few retained customers that were good customers, and I did this full time. You were asking about how big it got. When I received my John Dvorak Award in 94, they said 10 million people around the world are using it now. I have no way to verify that, but that's what they said, so I'll go with that number if they put it.
Do you get any remnant fame or interaction from it beyond me?
I hear from old beta testers every so often. I get emails. Just a couple of days ago, I got a few. What's most interesting is when I hired an employee about a year and a half ago, and I said, I always like to say, you ever use bulletin board systems? Yeah. You ever use something called offline mail, quick packets? One guy said, yeah, one of my employees. I said, well, I'm the guy who created it. And, you know, oh, I remember that. But these days, no, not very much. It's like another segment of my life that I look back. I mean, I'm wearing the Sparkware T-shirt today and all that. But you know, it's like almost another lifetime ago in some ways with what I'm doing now.
The industry that rises up almost entirely thanks to Jack, who basically creates a house organ and then starts creating these conventions. Had you been bringing quick packets and your readers and your servers to anything to sell them, or was it purely a, how did you let people know about it?
Oh, I never spent 10 cents on advertising. It was always word of mouth, bulletin boards, sysops. I had sysop packages where if you want to sell Qmail First Reader to your users, I'd sell it to you at a discount, and, you know, you go ahead and bundle it. Usually what sysops would do is they would bundle it into their subscription package, so it's a value-added service, things like that. Am I too low here?
No, you're fine. No, I'm doing what I do, which is making sure the whole system is... Normally there's a guy like this, and there's me asking the question, and sound dude. Well, guess what?
I know, so, you're doing everything. Just want to make sure I'm not too low.
You are fine, and I have everything if I want to knock it back up again. But go ahead. So, okay.
So I never spent a dime on advertising costs, ever. Never ran an ad. Always word of mouth. Downloads. Always made sure that when I had a release, it was hit on major boards immediately. Things like that. I had a good relationship with Canada Remote Systems, CRS, up in Toronto. They were a huge customer of mine. I would ship off 200 copies. I mean, I'd get a call from them saying, hey, Sparky, I need 200 tonight. You know, and I never told them no, because it was good money. And my wife and I would be sitting there just churning out the diskettes, and I would be rushing down to Federal Express. Since I lived in Memphis, I had till midnight to drop them off for shipment the next day, which worked out nicely. But Channel One in New York was a good customer. ExecNet, New York, I could go. I know I'm going to leave a lot out because I had a number of them, but those are the ones that just stand out right off the bat.
Well, they're the super BBSs.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they're the ones that are this bizarre phenomenon of the 64 and 72 and 100 line BBSs.
Kela BBS in Chicago was another one, yes.
When those show up, are those a surprise?
When Judd Newell contacted me at first and he was talking about the volume he was talking about, it was a pleasant surprise, yes.
But then, I mean, did you ever think that BBSs would get like that? I mean, that they would be these 100-line, multi-gigabyte storage things?
Back in 79, no way. I would say it dawned on me, as I was getting more and more into Qmail. I mean, we released in April of 88. And I was probably contacted by CRS, I would like to say, December 88, so there wasn't too much of a period of time there. I mean, I was dealing with bigger boards, but we always knew that, like CRS, what was the one up in Michigan, or Wisconsin, PA, help me out here.
Ripco? That's the only one I know in Chicago. Ripco.
No, in Wisconsin, they had the...
Oh, Wisconsin, ExecPC?
ExecPC, of course, yes. The bigger, huge ones.
The largest, quote unquote.
Right.
There's apparently a little bit of a battle between ExecPC and, Channel One is actually in Boston.
Yes.
But there's one in New York, whose name I don't know why I'm forgetting. I should know it very well. But the two of them, the one in New York and the one in Wisconsin, never refused to give up. They always refused to give up the crown. One would say, I have more lines. Then we'll go, I have more callers. It's like, I have more files, I have more traffic.
Yeah, Invention Factory in New York?
No. It's something.
Small.
Yeah, that's a smaller one. No, there's a. It's a super one. I really should know it because I'm going to go interview them, and they've become an ISP like everyone else.
Yeah.
They're now called FileLibrary.com, by the way.
Okay.
But they were once that. And Channel One, yeah. Where are we, people? It sounds to me, therefore, that you were not at BBSCon in the capacity as a vendor.
My first show was a disaster. It was a show called Gateway 89, run out of Paul Waldinger's system, and I bet that was the guy. Sound of Music?
No.
Okay. Just trying to remember.
All right.
Paul Waldinger put on a show at the Hilton. JFK Airport in May of 89, and I sunk a lot of money into that show, I think about $5,000, which, granted, wasn't a lot of money, but for me at the time it certainly was. Mm-hmm. And I remember, I think 150 people showed up, and I said, I'm never doing this again. I said, the promoter always inflates the numbers and things like that. I learned a valuable lesson at that time. Plus, I decided that the better way to do my work was not to have a booth and try and sell, because no, you could sell some copies, stuff like that, but the better way was to work, network the crowd, give talks, presentations, things like that. It was interesting that because everybody called me Sparky, it was an easy name to remember. That's the main reason I went with it, and I'll tell you a little story there, was that, I'll go back to the beginning about that just to get it on tape, is that
when I was 19 years old, working at Radio with Radio Shack. I never worked for Radio Shack. I want to state that on the record. Just never accepted any paycheck from Tandy Corporation. But I would go out with them on jobs where they would try and sell the hardware, and I would be there to sell the custom software. Well, there was the Radio Shack Computer Center manager there was Mick Anderson, and he started calling me Sparky. And for like two, I hated it. It was terrible. I said, I don't like, you know, whatever. For 2 years, I fought it, and I finally had to come up with a company name, and I decided, well, Sparkware works. You know, I might as well take it and go with it. So here I am at Sparkware since about 1982 or so. I end up calling John Friel to see if I could come up. He and I were going to go to Gateway 89, and I wanted to go up to his offices in Iowa a couple weeks before the show just to talk and get things coordinated. And so it's, I'm all calling his office, and girl answers, says, I said, can I speak to John Friel? And she says, may I ask who's calling? I said, Mark Herring. And she says, Mark Herring's on the phone. And I said, I hear John say, who? And I said, tell him Sparky's on the phone. Oh, yeah, picks up. I learned a valuable lesson right there, that Sparky is a name they will remember. So that's where I kept it. And I even had people asking for autographs. I mean, it sounds so strange now, giving, you know, in your own way, some of us became minor rock stars in our own little microcosm.
Right. I mean, one of the things that's interesting with BBS Con is that he unwittingly brings together a group of pioneers that in many cases didn't see themselves as the, you know, the highly esteemed figures that they are. You know?
You're right. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. He certainly did that. I remember in 93, BBS Con at Colorado Springs. He organized a lunch with myself, and I cannot remember the other developers, with Vint Cerf, to talk about the coming internet. Well, and the coming interface between us. At that time, I had already written a package for PC Board that provided newsgroup an email interface between the internet and PC Board. But he was always instrumental, I thought, in that area. There's some people who cannot stand Jack Rickard. I'm not one of them. I always thought he was a good guy.
Well, one of the things that really seems to come out when you look in retrospect is he is amazingly prescient. He sells his magazine for $28 million in 1998.
Mm-hmm.
Sticks around for about 6 months, and then it gets sold to some horrible company. And he's like, bye. And now he's, you know, buying, selling land, owns a few planes, does his thing.
Yes, I know. Last time I saw Jack was in 97 in Denver. And he said, you ought to, Sparky, you ought to get up there and write something. I said, Jack, I think the days of the one-man shop are over. Oh, no, you're better than that. There's still plenty of ideas out there. But
he's, you know,
still going. He's still doing it.
So, I mean, his whole approach to the magazine worked out. And his,
yes,
his constant, I mean, I've had to go ahead and read old Usenet messages where they're complaining, you know, in 94 and 95, you know, Jack's, you know, we really would be somewhere with this BBS thing if Jack would stop friggin' hammering on this idiotic internet idea.
Well, you got to understand, part of that, too, was fear. I mean, I had that fear at the time. When I can remember when Windows 95 was released. Well, let's back up just a little bit. I spent about 2 years developing my next major release of First Reader. I put it out on July the 20th, and sales go very nicely, like I expected to. Things were looking great. And then Windows 95 is released August 24th. Within 3 weeks, my sales had taken a hit of a third, never to come back. And it was apparent with the writing on the wall that the days of the glory BBSing were over with, that the internet was the coming thing. I started banging my head on the wall saying, why didn't I listen to people who said, look at this stuff? You know, at that time, more seriously than I did. So I got to give him that. But we were saying, other people in our same shoes were saying, it's just like, it's a fad. It's like CB radio. They'll come back and all that. And of course, you know, Jack was able to look back at the bigger picture and say, nah, it ain't going to happen, you know?
Yeah. Well, because the thing that's the common problem, right, is that people think, what they don't understand is, like, you know, there's a revival in old video games, people buying old video games. Mm-hmm. But they're not anymore, really. What's happened is there's become a small industry who are selling completely reconstructed games for like $1,500 a piece. They look like they just came off the lot because they're making the stuff new.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really quite the same. And in fact, the thing that's becoming even bigger is they create a brand new arcade-looking box. They sell a Pentium, 800 megahertz inside of it, and wire it up so it just plays 800 games instead of one, and mm-hmm. you can just choose whatever you want to and play it like the old days. But it's nothing like having the old games.
Mm-hmm.
So the old games are back, but it's not really back. And a lot of, I think, the things that are in BBSs show up today, but you can't compare the two, right? I mean, I'm seeing bulletin boards come back, but they're nothing that a person who used bulletin boards in the 80s would find acceptable.
Even more interesting is that it's interesting how now that we do have global telecommunications presence, I can send an email to someone in India as quickly as I can someone down the street, that it's so much more, less personal at this point. There's no sense of community that, at least maybe it's because I'm the old BBSer and I was used to that, but I have some hobbies. I frequent some forums, but they don't certainly feel that like they were home, like the old forums that I used to, BBSs I used to call.
The geography is gone.
Exactly. That's true. Very much so.
Part of the reason why I think that the BBSs of the future are wireless access points.
Could well be.
Because you'll know that everyone who's on, if they just strap on a BBS-like thing to it, you'll know everyone posting on it is within a mile.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know. But, you know, anyway. You know, you're finding out, obviously through your sales, how many people are affected by it. And like I said, that, and like you said, that number is pulled out of 10 million. But I mean, at the BBS cons, is that where people start? I mean, like obviously you meet your server customers often,
right?
But you rarely meet your reader customers because that stuff's just being passed around through a distribution network you never run into.
Correct. I can't meet them all. Right.
So, I mean, do you have that at these cons where people are coming up and all they are is a reader?
Yes.
And,
oh, yes. I remember one experience in Toronto. I was my first trip up there was for a local computer show that CRS was attending, and I had a relationship with CRS and also at the time their competitor, Rose Media, Vic Cass. So I spent some time at the CRS booth, and I spent some time at the Rose Media booth. And they were like in mortal combat between the two, so it was kind of strange at the time. But anyway, I was up there. They had a place name and all that stuff, and I had people come by. Hi, you know, I'm so and so, and I always tell them their serial number and things like that, just to give them a kick or something, because I just had a knack for numbers. Still do. That's about the only part of memory that hadn't failed me at this age. But I do remember one time that I had three people come up, and two of them were my customers, and they introduced themselves, and I said, you know, hey, nice to meet you, so-and-so, serial number, so-and-so, right? And then the other guy was smiling. He was quiet, and he said, I'm so-and-so, but I use Easy Reader. And I said, I know, Easy Reader number 38. And he just, huh? You know, at that point, oh, I kept tabs, and definitely. You know, I watched the competition. That was one of the things about this business, is that you could pretty much find out just do a little research, and you can find out what your competitors are easily doing, how well they're penetrating, and things like that. Plus, you get into clicks. Well, clicks were always big and stuff like that. And I'd have people who would want to tell me what's going on, you know, surreptitiously and things like that. It was, you had your intel sources.
Did you have much of a staff?
No, just myself and my wife to help out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it stays that way through everything?
Through everything. I was able to handle it all.
So your overhead is not insanely high?
What it takes to keep me alive.
Because a lot of, like for instance, the thing with Mustang is Mustang grows to be like, you know, 30, 40 people.
Yep.
And I've interviewed people at Mustang who were there, and they come out of it, you know, quite amazing to me. They come out with like a whole, think at one point one of the guys just says, you know, Mustang built this house. You know, this is where my family and I live.
What are they doing now? I know they got bought out in 99 or 2000. It was February 2000.
They were bought out by a company. Actually, yeah, they're bought out in late 1999 by a company that the CEO steals $19 million from. So the company collapses in on itself and is bought out by Avaya. They've long ago spun off the BBS product to another company.
Santronics.
Yeah.
And Hector Santos. Are you interviewing him?
I'm trying.
You'll have an interesting one, I think.
All of we're at the end of this tape, pretty much.
All right.
So let me move this here. We'll go for a second one, because I think we got enough here for a second one. But,
sure.
I call them the vultures, the guys who, like, came in at the end and said, you know, oh, that, you know. The ones who bought the rights to these BBSs in, like, the late 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I contacted them, like, I tracked them down, the reaction almost to a man is like, here comes the payoff. You know, like, they bought the property, and they're thinking, oh, here comes the media. The media's going to start sniffing around, and then everyone's going to start buying them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they've done nothing with them. They just have the rights.
Right.
And I'm just like, oh, yeah, that's exactly what I am. I'm part of the Renaissance. I'm just the lead in. But a couple of them, and then they all have very interesting personalities. I think if I had to quote it, I'd say the general going price for the rights to one of these things was between $5,000 and $10,000. That seems to be what it worked out to.
Yeah.
So to them, they only drop $5,000, wait for the payoff, and sometimes it's pretty funny. So I guess if they were, you know, they ought to be buying patents. That seems to be the way to go. Somebody's now suing every company that sells something on the internet.
Yes, I read about that. Slash
very, very clever way to do it too. Certainly for places like when there was a guy who was suing every company that made video games.
Uh-huh.
He just went quietly to each company one at a time.
Smaller ones, yeah.
Yeah, and then just started taking, you know. Uh-huh. But like Nintendo paid him off, you know, $25,000. They paid him like $25,000 or $50,000.